opportunity to heartily welcome our beloved principal for his support and encouragement and giving organizing this online workshop during COVID-19 pandemic and having kindly accepted to grace this function. Welcome, sir. I welcome all the resource persons from the reputed institutions like IITs, NIITs, IISc, IMSc, Central University, and other reputed engineering colleges for readily accepting our invitation and to deliver lecture in spite of their busy schedule. Welcome you all, sir. Next, I take this opportunity to welcome and thank wholeheartedly the conveners, Mrs. A. Meena Kumari, Assistant Professor, Department of Mathematics, and Mr. R. Gurusamy, Assistant Professor, Senior Grade, Department of Mathematics, for their untiring effort in making this workshop a grand success by working with an excellent team spirit. Finally, I welcome my department colleagues and all the participants from all over India. Once again, I welcome you all for this workshop. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, for your nice words. Now I invite Mrs. A. Meena Kumari, Assistant Professor of Mathematics and convener of this online workshop, to introduce the chief guest. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Gurusamy sir. Very, very good evening to all. I deem it a great pleasure to welcome the resource person, Dr. G. Arun Kumar, who is going to handle the first session of this online workshop. He is a postdoctoral fellow in the Department of Mathematics, IIT Bangalore. He completed his UG and PG degree in Ayanada Janayammal College, Varanasi, and he earned his PhD degree in IMSc Chennai. He achieved MSc scholarship from NBHM India. He got JRF and lectureship from SESAR in the year 2011. He passed the competitive exams like GATE with a rank 384 out of 3,793. And also he achieved a state level eligibility test. And he got postdoctoral fellowship from NBHM in the year 2019. He published more articles in the reputed international journals. And he's a very right person to start this session. And due to this COVID, we have more number of registered participants for this workshop. And we welcome all the participants. And also on behalf of our department and MedQuotient Engineering College, I thank him for accepting our invitation. Thank you, sir.
With this few introductions, I invite Dr. G. Arun Kumar sir to deliver this lecture. Thank you, sir. Welcome. Okay, thank you, madam. Thank you, Meena madam, and thank you everybody from MedQuotient Engineering College, especially to Gurusamy sir and for the management of MedQuotient Engineering College for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Usually I take linear algebra and abstract algebra, like so this time for a change I thought of I'll take linear real analysis. So that, I mean, I'm really excited to look at real analysis after some time. Okay. So what are we going to do? So we're going to, I'm going to give like six lectures. Like we'll do continuous functions, uniform continuous function, differentiability and integrable functions. And I'll do some sequence of functions and the series of functions also. On the way, we solve the questions from CSIR, GATE, NBHM, and whatever real analysis questions are asked in those question papers, whichever is related to thing what I'm teaching, we will see that questions also. Okay. So, and like one thing about how to prepare for this exam, like maybe if I talk about how to prepare for exam, that alone I have to, I usually teach, speak for 15 to 20 minutes, but I have got only 6 hours, and like I have real analysis is a big subject. So one thing I want to say, there is only one way to clear any competitive exam. You have to work every single day. Okay. So that is the only way. If you want to clear any exam, CSIR, GATE or NBHM, whatever, like you start study from today and you fix a schedule at least 1 hour a day, or at least like 45 minutes worst case, and keep that time especially for preparing exam, and do that every single day. Okay, then any exam you can clear very easily, and you solve previous year questions with the good, with the help of good textbooks. Okay, if you start reading some good textbooks also, textbooks will give you idea on how to approach problems, and there are other resources also to approach previous year questions from CSIR, K8, NBHM, all these exams. Today we're going to see mainly about continuous functions, examples, and its properties, and so on. Think of me as your senior, someone like you can just unmute your mic and you can ask me your doubts at any time. Okay. Yeah. Don't worry about it. It's a small doubt, big doubt, nothing like that. So all of us are whoever attending these lectures are our friends only. So just ask your doubts. Don't hesitate. Unmute your mic and ask if it is if the class is interactive, I will be very happy. Okay. So maybe first I'll share my screen. My voice is audible to everybody, right? Nobody has issues with my voice.
Yes, audible.
Okay, so I hope with the participants also it's fine. Okay, let me share my screen. Okay, so I suppose everybody can see my screen now. Screen is visible now, sir?
Yes, visible, sir.
Okay. So before we go into continuous functions, as I said, I'll point to some nice, some references where you can look for answers to your doubts and some good lecture notes to understand the concepts, things like that. So I suppose many of you guys know Maths DAC Exchange website where you can ask your doubts. Okay, so it is a very nice website. Usually you can ask your doubts. First, you have to say what you have tried a little bit. Then they usually you get an answer. So Maths DAC Exchange, for example, you see this problem. My method to calculate integral 0 to 1 log power 2020 x dx. So somebody asked this question. Okay, they have some doubts and they have added their attempt also. Then they will get some good answers, how to do it, things like that. Okay, so it is a very good website where if you struck at some problem, you can always ask the doubts here. And there is a search here. If you just look for just a continuous function, say. Continuous functions. See, you have at least 500 results. There will be lot of many interesting problems being discussed here with the answers. If you look at this determine all continuous functions, there is one answer already. Let's see what is this question is about. X be a metric space and Y be a discrete metric space. Determine all continuous functions F from Y to X. So these questions are very interesting questions. We have seen similar questions in previous year exam also. Okay. So I just randomly look for some problems in I was just searching for continuous functions. Then I found many interesting problems here. So it is a good resource, Maths DAC Exchange. So this one you can check and. Then there is this notes by, so the videos will be uploaded in the MEPCOS Link Engineering College YouTube channel. So you can always go back and check what is the website of these addresses. Okay, so don't worry, if I'm going a little fast about these resources. Okay, so this is a very nice website. Some expository papers are given. So they just explain the concepts. Okay, if you understand something very clearly, you can answer any problems related to that also very easily. So you see, you can see the silo theorems, proof of Cauchy's theorem, group of order 12, many such important concepts are given. There is something for analysis also. So infinite series. So for analysis, it is very less only, but for algebra, there are lots of things are given. They explain with many examples and the concepts are very clearly given. So you can look at this website also. Then for books, for real analysis, definitely Baby Rudin, where is Rudin? So Principles of Mathematical Analysis, Walter Rudin. And always it's good to look at 4 or 5 textbooks. Now you all know how to where to get the soft copies of all these books. So you can download more than one books. And suppose if you're looking at a continuous problem about continuous function from say some GATE question paper, and you don't know which one is the correct option. So what you can do, you can suppose you have 4 or 5 books on real analysis. in each book you can look at the continuous function chapter and see what are the results are given, what are the examples are given, what are the exercises are given. Can you relate the results or examples and the exercise with the problem given in the question paper? So you try to relate the problem with the things given in the book. That way you can you can solve the problem. Okay, that will improve your understanding also over the time. So first book I prefer is Walter Rudin, then this Introduction to Reanalysis, Bartle and Shepherd is one of my favorite books. Another is Methods of Reanalysis, Richard R. Goldman. Okay, so you might have some your favorite books. These are my favorite books. There are some more. For example, there is one problem book. The Terence Stowe's Analysis 1 and 2 are also good. Yeah, it's very, very well written. You can look at that book also. Okay. We have to go back. Okay, so I don't know what happened. How to close it? Okay, no problem. So another thing is for problem solving, this book is very nice. There are three volumes. This is the first volume. How to get rid of this screen? Okay, so problems in mathematical analysis 1, real numbers and sequence in series. So this is the volume 1 and this is volume 2, continuity and differentiation. There is volume 3 on integration. So these books are very nice book. And what else is there? These are some important references for real analysis. Okay. So maybe we can just... start the session. Okay, so properties of continuous functions. So that is the plan for today. Okay. So mainly we look at continuous functions from R to R, because in many problems related to functions from R to R is asked in various competitive exams. Okay, so let's just see the formal epsilon delta definition of continuous functions. Then we try to understand what is the meaning of it. Then we try to solve some problems also using just the definition. Okay. So let me take a function from R to R and I am fixing a point A belongs to R. Okay. So continuity, usually we speak continuity at a point. So we say that the function F is continuous at the point A if given epsilon greater than 0. This symbol means that there exists. Okay, given an epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0 such that modulus of x minus a less than delta implies modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. Okay, so very first time when anybody sees this definition, everybody will feel a little bit uncomfortable. So once you understand what is the meaning of this statement, then so there are other definitions of continuous functions also, using sequences, inverse, and another thing is inverse image of open set is open, closed set is closed. Many people think that the definition is much easy to understand, but once you understand epsilon delta, then using this definition you can solve problems very easily. Okay, let's see. So how to understand this? So it is saying that given a epsilon greater than 0, you have to find a delta such that this condition is satisfied. Okay, so let's try to understand what is the meaning of these conditions. So basically it says that, so to visualize this definition better, we take functions from R2 to R2. Okay, because in R2, the neighborhoods are disk. Okay, if you look at B of A comma R, what does it mean? It means that the open ball center at A of radius R, if you draw this in R2, this will be like a disk. Disk means that you draw a circle of radius R about the point A, then the points lying inside this circle. Okay, that is what the open neighborhood of the point A of radius R. Now So given epsilon, so we are given an epsilon. What you do once you're given an epsilon, so you look at the point A. I fix this is my point A. I want to prove this function is continuous at this point A, and I assume that its image is this point f of A. Okay, so if it's a function from R2 to R2, this is my domain R2, this is my codomain R2. So if I take a point in the domain, its image f of A will be in the codomain. Now suppose epsilon is given. Once the epsilon is given, what I will do, I'll draw a open ball of radius epsilon around f of A. Okay, this is what first I'll do. Okay, once I draw this, what I want to do is I want to find a delta such that if a point x is within the distance delta of the point A, then its image should be within the distance. There is a typo, sorry. So whenever there is a point x within the distance delta from A, then its image f of x should stay within the distance epsilon of the find f of A. So what is the meaning of it? So you have to find the delta here such that if you take any point inside this disk, so you are taking a point inside this disk means the distance between these two points will be less than delta. Okay, because this is a open ball center at A of radius delta, that means that any point inside this disk will have distance less than r, less than delta. Okay, so this condition says that if you take any point here and if you look at its image f of x, the distance between f of x and f of A should be less than epsilon. In other words, you are given a epsilon. First, you are given a epsilon. You draw the disk of radius epsilon around f of A. You have to prove f is continuous at A. You have to find a delta, some delta such that if you take any point inside this disk, its image should lies inside this disk. Okay, so if it is a continuous function, we will see many, we're going to see many examples. So it will make better sense when you see a lot of examples. So this same condition can be rewritten like this.
Hello.
Hello.
Sir, can we take function from R to R?
Yeah. So I have one more example from R to R also, for example, here. So we'll get to that. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yeah. Sure. Okay. So we, by the definition, we know that the B of A comma delta is set of points lying within the distance delta from the point A. Similarly, B of F of A comma epsilon. Now, so the same definition can be rewritten like this. F is continuous at the point A if given epsilon greater than zero, there exists a delta greater than zero such that image of the delta ball of the point A is contained in the epsilon ball of the image f of A. Okay. For example, if you see, like that is what we proved here, we observed here. So anything within the distance delta from A should be mapped to something within the distance epsilon from f of A. That means that this entire disk is mapped inside this disk. That is what it means. Okay, so the same definition I have rewritten like this. So this definition, this interpretation will be very, very useful. Okay, we're going to use it in many places. So is this definition clear to everybody? Like why this is true? Why continuous at A means
yes, sir.
This in, okay. Yes, what about others? Like, is there anybody has some doubts in this? So
no, sir,
if you have some
clear.
Doubts. Okay, so anybody has some doubts, please stop me at any time. Okay, let's continue.
Sir, I have one doubt.
Please.
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, we are using that epsilon greater than zero, there exists delta greater than zero. So
right.
So while defining the value of epsilon, is there any condition that it should be closer to zero, or it is a large value like that?
Yeah. Okay. So maybe if our next point, maybe make it that our next point will answer you to that question. Okay. Let's see.
Okay.
Okay.
Thanks.
So yeah, sure. I will explain also.
Sir.
Hello.
Sir, you have used d of x comma a less than delta, right, sir?
Right, because it is in R2. So
yes, sir. You are using a metric d. So is it same? The definition is same for every metric, any metrics, or for usual metrics only we are using?
No. For any metric, this is the same definition only. But instead of modulus, I should take d of x comma a here, distance between f of x comma f of a.
So any metrics, any okay. if you take any metric, the same formula.
The same thing, same thing will work. Yeah, but again, for pictorial representation, usually R and R2 are much easier to explain.
Like
if it is arbitrary metric space, we don't have any picture. Okay, so now suppose you fix, so you for a epsilon, suppose you have already find a delta such that the image of this disk goes inside this disk. Okay, then if you look at the some other delta 1, which is smaller than this delta, then this image will also go inside this disk, right? Because if the bigger disk is mapped into this disk by the function f, then the smaller radius disk will also mapped into this disk. Okay, so what it means, that means is like for an epsilon, suppose if you find one delta, then any delta smaller than delta will also work. Okay, any number less than the delta will also work. That is one thing. Now, suppose for an epsilon, if you find a delta already, and now I am increasing epsilon. Okay, suppose this is my new, say this is my epsilon 1. For this epsilon 1, whatever delta we find for this epsilon, the same delta will work. Because already f takes this disk into this disk. So now I'm increasing the size of the disk. It's not going to disturb anything, right? Because the same delta will work. Because still the image of this disk is lying inside this disk only, okay? So basically, if you for a epsilon, if you get a delta, you can reduce the delta also. That is not going to affect this property. Similarly, for an epsilon, if you already got a delta, you can increase epsilon also, and the same delta will work. Okay, so to answer his question whether epsilon is greater than zero or it can be large, so once you get a delta, you can increase epsilon to anything, the same delta will work. Okay, but you cannot reduce epsilon. If you reduce the epsilon, then delta you might need to change. For example, suppose this is my new epsilon 1, okay? Then whatever delta we got for epsilon, that need not go inside this new epsilon 1, okay? Because some of these points might go outside also, so that won't work, okay? So these observations are clear. Delta can be made small without affecting the conditions of continuity, and like epsilon can be made. So delta can be made small. Epsilon can be made large. There is no problem. So usually delta is, usually we take it to be very small.
I have a doubt. So then is there any condition, is there any relation between the delta and epsilon?
So by the definition, there is no any relation except this disk is mapped into this disk. That is the only relation between epsilon and delta. But for some functions, you will have for example, uniformly continuous functions. Okay. So when the function is uniformly continuous, you usually have very nice relation between epsilon and delta. For example, if you look at the identity function, so we're going to see all these smaller examples next. So there epsilon is actually equal to delta. Okay, so that is one relation. Sometimes epsilon equal to root of delta equal to sometimes root of epsilon. So depends on the function, the relation between delta and epsilon keep changes. Sometimes there is no relation also. Okay, if the sometime
given a epsilon and the point, you will get a delta. Once you change the point from, instead of looking at continuity at A, now I'm going to look at the continuity at some other point B. Now for, so f of B might be here. So suppose I draw the same epsilon neighborhood to here. Okay, then here I don't there is no guarantee that I'll same delta will work here. There is no guarantee. Okay, usually delta depends on the point also. Okay, all these things are we will see, but in general delta depends on the point also, not just epsilon. So there may not be direct relation between epsilon and delta. Okay, so let's see some problems. So these are all CSIR problems. Maybe first let's see this problem. So how many of you have seen this problem already? The question number 25. I think whoever, I mean, you might have, if you have already seen some CSIR previous year question paper, so this is one problem from that. So it is asked in 2017 December. Okay. So let's look at that question. Like S is given to be set of all functions from R to R such that so it's function satisfying the R axis to epsilon greater than zero. It means that there is one epsilon greater than zero such that for all delta greater than zero, whatever delta you take. So for all delta means that delta can be any positive real number. Okay. And so there is some epsilon and delta satisfying this condition. Mod x minus y less than delta implies modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. Then we have which of the following is true. So like many times what happens, like it looks like a kind of definition of continuous function. So many people tend to think that the answer is continuous function. So anybody know what is the answer to this question? But yeah, continuous, uniform, continuous, none of them are answer. Anybody know the answer to this question?
Uniformly continuous, sir.
No, that is
it should be bounded.
Will it be constant?
Yeah, constant,
bounded. Sir, three. Sir, f is bounded.
Yeah, so
bounded.
You know why it is so?
But yeah. Why it cannot
so
be
the
constant?
Correct answer is f is. I will tell you why it is.
Because there exists an epsilon for all the delta. That's why.
So I mean, for every epsilon, there exists delta greater than zero, then only the condition holds for uniformly continuous. Here it is given that there exists epsilon greater than zero. Am I right, sir?
So we can maybe see. Okay, I will tell you I will explain why this condition means boundedness. Okay, so like many of you said, it is bounded. Boundedness is the right answer. So so there is one epsilon, okay, such that modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. This side is fine. If you look at this side, for all delta greater than zero and mod x minus y less than delta. Okay, so you take any real number. Say you take two arbitrary real numbers, x, y belongs to R. Since I have zoomed it is writing like this. Okay, so we take let x comma y belongs to R. Okay, then it's a modulus of x. So these two numbers are arbitrary real numbers. You look at its modulus of x minus y, then this modulus of x minus y is less than delta for some delta. For example, like you take this distance, mod x minus y is number, suppose this is 10, you take this number delta to be 11. Okay, so what I'm saying is, you take any real number, there is always a delta such that modulus of x minus y is less than delta. Okay, you find the distance, always you add one and you take that number to be delta. Okay, so from this what we are seeing is this condition for all delta greater than zero mod x minus y less than delta means that this condition is true for any two xy belongs to R. So basically the given I will again tell you, but first I'll write. So basically, this given condition says that for all x comma y belongs to R, modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon. That is what the given condition is says. Why? Because like for all delta greater than zero and mod x minus y less than delta. Whenever mod x minus y less than delta, modulus of f of x minus f of y less than epsilon, that is what is given. But when mod x minus y is less than delta, so when 2x and y satisfies mod x minus y less than delta, that is the question. But this delta can be any number. Okay, so you take two real numbers, arbitrary real numbers, and that real number will satisfy this inequality for a suitable choice of delta. Okay, so for this arbitrary xy belongs to R also, this right side is satisfied because left side is satisfied for a suitable choice of delta. So basically what they are saying is for all xy belongs to R, modulus of f of x minus f of y is less than epsilon. So that means that you have a function and you look at the image of the function. In the image, if you look at the distance between any two points, that is less than epsilon. Okay, so like you know, range of a function everybody knows, right? So range of f is the set of all f of x such that x belongs to R. So you consider the range of this function. In this range, you take any two points, then the distance between them is less than epsilon, and the epsilon is a fixed number. There is a epsilon. So that means that this is a range of f is a subset of R, because it is a function from R to R. So range is basically a subset of R. You have a subset of R in which any two points are distance at most epsilon. Okay, that means that set is a bounded set. Okay, only in bounded set this condition is satisfied. The distance between any two points is at most epsilon. So instead of this epsilon, you take, if you think of it as some m, then you will understand very clearly, less than m. So like if instead of epsilon, if you write this definition as m, you will see that the basically it means that the range, in the range, distance between any two points is at most m. That means that the set is a bounded set. So range is bounded means that the function is a bounded function. Okay, a function is said to be bounded if modulus of f of x less than or equal to k for all x belongs to R. In other words, the range should be bounded set. Okay, that is a equivalent definition. So only one thing is to understand is for all delta greater than zero, mod x minus y less than delta means that for all xy belongs to R. Saying these two things are equivalent. Okay. So maybe why bounded is maybe clear to you, but again it is a part B problem, so only one option should be true. And you see why it is not continuous, why it is not uniformly continuous. Such options, if you want to discuss, you just take the function f of x equal to 1 if x belongs to q, minus 1 if x doesn't belongs to q. Technically you can take any bounded function, any bounded but not continuous function, you can take that bound. So if it is a bounded function, then this condition will satisfy. Okay, but a bounded function need not be continuous, therefore this option will be false. Or for example, you take f of x equal to 1 if x belongs to q, minus 1 if x doesn't belongs to q. This is a bounded function because the range has only two points, and this is clearly, we will see that this is not a continuous function. Okay, so and if it is not continuous, then definitely it is not uniformly continuous also. And it is they are saying that this collection should be constant, but again you take this function will satisfy this condition. You can take epsilon to be, for example, 3. Any number greater than 2 will work, because the distance between 1 and minus 1 is 2, right? You take epsilon to be 2.1. okay, then you, for any xy belongs to R, I mean mod x minus y is less than delta for some delta, that is for sure. And the image is like going to be either this point or this point, so distance between them is always 2 is less than 2.1. okay, So I'm not sure like how much all of you guys have understood, but basically the given condition means only bounded. Okay, if you have some doubts, like you try to understand this given condition more clearly. Okay.
It is clear that before this we get that open ball A and R. Mm. The R is the radius and A is the distance point. So here we get the closed ball.
Not really, but open ball only, but its radius is can be arbitrarily large. This delta is for all delta. Okay, so maybe if you want to look at using the diagram, so it says that there is a one single epsilon such that how big ever delta you draw, its image will go inside this epsilon. That is what the given condition is saying. Basically, that means that it is a bounded function because image is bounded. Image can be put inside a disk.
Sir, before this, you said that we can large the epsilon, but we have to make smaller the delta. Now you are taking delta is lower.
That is for continuous function. Here we are not talking about continuous function.
Sir, if we fix this delta, then it can be continuous?
No, it cannot.
No. Because again, for continuity, you need for all epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta you want. Right? But it is given that for one epsilon and the existence of one delta, it's not sufficient. Okay. So if you look at our definition, like given epsilon greater than 0, basically it means that for all epsilon greater than 0. Okay. Because
okay, it is okay. So for particular delta, it will continue.
No, it is not.
We don't say like that. If for every epsilon, if you can find a delta satisfying this, then only we say that it is a continuous.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, basically, sir, if we are fixing delta, then we are not sure that for all epsilon, we are getting the delta.
Okay, if the problem is
sorry, come again? With,
sir, can I answer?
Please.
Yeah. If the problem is interchanged with the there exists and delta,
yes.
Then the solution will be the continuous.
If you change this for all to here and there exists to here, then that is precisely the definition of continuous.
We cannot say the uniform continuous, sir, correct?
No, even if it is not continuous, definitely not uniform continuous.
No, in case of interchanging the delta and epsilon, place of delta and epsilon, after
then
that...
Then it is continuous, then uniform.
Can you please speak? Let me speak first, then we will answer.
Okay.
So, I want to say, if I interchange the position of delta and epsilon here, so it says there exists delta greater than 0, such that for all epsilon greater than 0, this inequality satisfied. So, it is going to be continuous, that's good. But is it going to be uniformly continuous?
So, uniform continuity is like at the end, you need for all x comma y belongs to R at the end. Okay, so that is some way it is a completely a different concept. Okay, okay. I mean it is related to continuity, but I prefer to discuss it separately. Let's postpone uniform continuity for tomorrow. First we see the definition of uniform continuity tomorrow, then it will be much clearer. Even problems there are many uniformly continuous related problems in a gate NBHM, but I avoid all of them. I thought, okay, let's do it uniform continuity one go tomorrow. Yes. Okay,
thank you.
If I were to prove this rigorously that F be bounded, I think that I will use the idea of triangle inequality inside the range.
It's matter of what is your definition of bounded function. Okay. So what I'm saying is so usually we say that a function is bounded if modulus of f of x, well, let me write. So f is bounded if modulus of f of x is less than or equal to k for all x belongs to R. Okay. So basically it means that range of f is contained in minus k comma k. for some k, correct?
Yeah.
So like this is same thing. I mean, you don't need to prove anything because it is, I mean, this is the definition of bounded function. Like, because you see, the given condition says, the given condition says that in the range, if you take two points, it is distance is less than epsilon.
Yeah.
Okay. So that means that, like that condition and this condition is basically same, right? Like, range of f contained in minus k comma k means here distance between any two points can be maximum 2k. Right?
Yeah, it is.
Here we are saying that distance between any two points is maximum epsilon.
Yeah.
Like basically this is just a definition, like nothing much to prove also. Like once we understand the definition of bounded functions or bounded set, then this is just a matter of understanding only. Yeah. So again, you solve 1,000 problems doesn't mean that like you can solve this problem on the exam hall. Like, if you just know what is meaning of boundedness, if you have the like clear conceptual knowledge, then you can just immediately do that. Actually, it is a part B problem. Literally, you cannot spend more than 2-3 minutes, right? Yeah. So in CSIR, like it is a part B problem, like for three marks only. And so like if it is a part C problem, you can spend like some 4-5 minutes, but part B, better you do it within couple of minutes. Okay. Anyway, like let's move on. Like, so this is another problem. Let X be a metric space and F from X to R be a continuous function. Let G set of all X comma F of X be the graph of F. Then G is homeomorphic to X. So, I mean, we are just doing continuous function only, but I'm already doing homeomorphism. So we are not going to go linear. Okay, linear means, okay, first continuity, differentiation, inter. Like some problems, if we can solve, we do that problem also because my number of lectures is limited. Okay, so within that available sessions, I try to cover as much as possible. Like in this kind of function, what is homeomorphism? Okay.
Please unmute your mic.
You suppose X and Y are metric spaces. A function F from X to Y is said to be a homeomorphism if one F should be a bijection, two F should be continuous, and third F inverse also continuous. Okay, so this is the definition of homeomorphism. A function between metric spaces said to be homeomorphism if it is a bijection and it should be continuous and F inverse is also continuous. But again, pretty much this function required only the knowledge of what is a continuous function or how the graph of a continuous function looks like. Okay, so you take X to be R and this problem can be answered. That is why I wrote this problem. So G is the graph of the function F. So for example, I have drawn some example like, so basically like if it is a continuous function from R to R, like its graph will be something like this, right? And they are saying that like this graph, whether, so this graph, it is homeomorphic to what? That is a kind of, that is a question. So the options are G is homeomorphic to. So let's try to do this problem for R first, and then we'll see for an arbitrary metric space. R. I mean, at least from problem point of view, we can do it. I mean, this problem can be solved by assuming X equal to R. Okay, so it is a part C problem. So basically, more than one option can be correct. Let's see. So if you take X to be R, then the options are G is homeomorphic to R. So the graph of the function is homeomorphic to R. Second option is G is homeomorphic to R. Okay, so this is little tricky. For example, for this option, you have to assume, say, domain is closed 0, 1. Okay, suppose domain is closed 0, 1. How the graph of the function will looks like? For example, suppose this is my, say, 0. This is my 1, okay? Then the graph of the function is only this much, right? The graph of the function will be only this much. basically it will be like a kind of line segment. So that cannot be homeomorphic. Okay. I think I shouldn't have put this one problem here. That can be, that is compact. That is compact. Yeah, that is fine. Okay. Okay, so we'll go one first. We'll go up each option one after the other. First, let's do the easier one. So the third option says that G is homeomorphic to R cross R. Okay, let's see why that is false. Okay, so if you put X equal to R, basically third option and the fourth option is the same options. So once I eliminate the third option is false, then fourth option is false. Okay, so to prove some option is false, you enough to give one example. Okay, so I take X to be R and I prove that this option is false, then it is fine. So once you take X to be R, we are looking at the continuous functions from R to R. So basically it graph will looks like this. Okay, now we claim that this curve, it cannot be homeomorphic to R cross R. Okay, so if there is a homeomorphism, then there is a bijection between R cross R to just points on this curve. Okay, you collect the points on this curve and you call it G. That is the graph of this function. There will be a bijection between these two sets, which is continuous in both sides. Like F is also continuous, then F inverse is also continuous. Okay, now do you know why like this curve cannot be homeomorphic to R cross R? See, this graph and real line are homeomorphic. Okay, so homeomorphism means so you can just expand it, fold again. This curve sort of like x-axis only, the real line only, but it has some bends. That is not a problem. Like it is just bending here and there, but except for that, it looks like real line only. So real line and this curve is homeomorphic. So how to prove these two points are homeomorphic? I mean this curve and
actually, G is a subset of R plus R, sir.
Yeah, that is true. But first let's do this. So you take the this graph of a continuous function from R to R. We claim that this curve and x-axis, they are homeomorphic. So basically I need a bijection which is continuous in both the directions, right? So if you take a point on this curve, it is of the form x comma f of x, and x is this point. Okay, if x is this point, then this point is x comma f of x. So what you do, you define a continuous function from real line to this curve and map x to f of x. That is a bijection. So you send x to f of x, and the inverse is x comma f of x goes to x. Okay, so one can prove that this is a this map also bijection, this map is also bijection. So this these two things are homeomorphic. So basically you can replace this G by R, because R and G are homeomorphic, and R cross and R cross R and R, they are not homeomorphic, because there is no continuous onto function from R cross R to R. There is no continuous bijection from R cross R to R. Why? Suppose there is a continuous bijection from R cross R to R. What you do, this is connected, again this is also connected. Now you remove zero from R cross R. Okay, then still R cross R will be connected, but in the image you will remove f of zero. Okay, suppose f is a bijective continuous function from R cross R to R, suppose. Okay, what you do, you remove zero from the domain. Okay, so when you remove zero from the domain, you remove f of zero.
Zero means zero comma zero. Or
zero means zero comma zero. Correct. Yeah, yeah. Okay, so you remove zero comma zero in the domain. Maybe you want to write something like this. So once you remove, when you remove this point, you remove its image also in the codomain. So what happens is the function, if you restrict f to this set, its codomain will be this set, because it is a bijection. So I remove only one point, I remove corresponding image also. So restriction of a continuous function will be continuous. But in the R2, if you remove a point, it will it remains connected. Okay. But in R, if you remove a point, it will not be connected. It will be disconnected. Okay. So continuous image of a connected set, you will get disconnected set. So that is not possible. So basically, it means that there is no continuous onto function from. So there is no continuous bijection from R2 to R. Okay. So that's what it means. We are spending too much time here. We really want to do only continuous functions. So I shouldn't have gone to homeomorphism. That I should have postponed for later lectures. So let's do continuous functions.
Excuse me,
okay.
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
Sir, that I have understood that why R cross R is not homeomorphic to R, but why G is not homeomorphic to R cross R, sir? If I not go via R, then directly how could I say that R cross R is not homeomorphic to G?
Like the same argument you can do. Suppose there is a homeomorphism. We claim that there is no. Basically, if you remove a point,
there
from
is no bijection actually.
If you remove a point from R, it is disconnected. In this curve also, in G also, if you remove a point, it will be disconnected. Right. So instead R, you can just replace G. The same argument will work. This is called like a one point removal argument. Okay, so in R cross R, like if you remove a point, it will remains connected, but in R, if you remove a point, it will be disconnected. So such spaces cannot be homeomorphic to each other.
Then sir, what will be the answer of this question?
So the answer to the question is the graph is G is homeomorphic to R, or G is homeomorphic to X.
Yes, sir.
Option one is the right option. Okay. So for a second option, you should look at the you should take x to be close 0, 1 and see why this option is wrong. And 3 and 4, we just say why it is false. Okay. Anyway, so lot of things to cover for me. Like it is 6:30 to 8, right? Okay. I haven't even started my lecture.
Sir, one question I have to ask.
Yeah, please.
Sir, you have told that there is no continuous bijection from R cross R to R, right?
Right.
Yeah. So I want to relax this condition. I want to say that if I take like one functions, like continuous function can exist from R cross R to R. There are a lot of, and also there is one functions also R cross R to R.
There exists a one function. Yeah. You know why there can be exist a one function from R to R?
Yeah, because they have the same cardinality.
Yeah, they are the same cardinality, correct. So yeah, further what you are asking. Yeah.
So I want to, like you quoted in between, like there does not exist continuous onto function, is it?
No, there are continuous onto function. You can look at the projection onto the first coordinate.
Thank you. So that is the bijection.
I was misreading. No, that is not a bijection, that is onto.
No. That bijection only doesn't exist. Otherwise,
there will be a continuous surjective map exist, but even continuous injection won't exist.
Okay, continuous injection doesn't exist.
Yeah, same reason. Like because domain is connected, so codomain has to be connected. So codomain will be some interval in R. So again, you can remove a point and you can argue like that. Okay. We will see all this. Like I have some problems in like related to continuity and connectedness. We will see all these things again. Like if some people don't understand it, don't worry. Like we're going to rigorously see all these things. Okay. So now like the same definition, how to visualize in case of R to R. So when you look at the functions from, so maybe I'll just erase all of them. It is right. So I look at functions from R to R, and I fix this point A.
Sir, I wish to share an idea about previous posting, and want to know that whether it is correct or not.
Yeah, please. Sir, this is wrong, right?
I can map a function from G to X, say H, from G to X, such that H of X equal to X comma F of X.
Right.
Sir, this is bijection. Okay, sir.
Yes. So, like, that is correct. That is what I said also. Like, you remember? So, basically, this is our X domain. Domain is our X, and this is our G. I told you the bijection. Like, X goes to X comma F of X is a one-side map, and inverse map is X comma F of X goes to X. Okay, so like from the domain, so if it is a function from R to R, this is the domain, this is the codomain, and we want to prove G is homeomorphic to X, we need a bijection between domain to the graph G. So I said like, so you take a point in the domain, it's you map it to X comma F of X. Conversely, from the G to X, you define the map, X comma F of X goes to X. So these two maps are inverses to each other. Therefore, they are bijection. And so this map is a projection onto first projection. Coordinate. Therefore, yes. It is a continuous map. And in the inverse map also, you can argue like there is this, what is it called? Tube lemma or something like. So first coordinate is continuous and the second coordinate is just the function F. We know it is continuous. So you can use the sequence criterion. X and 10 to A implies F of X and converges to F of A. You need to use the fact that this projection maps are continuous. That is what you need. But what you are saying is your argument is perfectly correct. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Okay. So the same definition, how to visualize in case of R. So in case of R, to functions from R to R, you see this is our domain R. This is our codomain R, okay? And I take a point here and we say that the function is continuous at this point A if given epsilon greater than 0. So what do I do? Once I get the epsilon, I draw this epsilon neighborhood around F of A. So suppose this, if this is my curve, okay? And this is my A, how to find F of A? So basically I should go straight to this point, and wherever the curve, this straight line x equal to a line, right? This is x equal to a line. So this line is x equal to a line, right? And this line, all the points will have x coordinate a, only y coordinate will vary. So this line, wherever it touches the x axis, you take the turn and you come here and you see. Whatever you are seeing here, that is the image of the point F of A, okay? Because in X code, in the R2 plane, we usually mark the points like this, X comma Y. It means that this is X, this is Y, but now Y axis is the image or codomain. So this point is now X comma F of X. Or in other words, A comma F of A, okay? So once I am given a epsilon, I draw this epsilon neighborhood. So in R, if you draw the epsilon neighborhood of the point F of A, that is basically the neighborhood F of A plus epsilon and F of A minus epsilon, this interval. This is the epsilon neighborhood of this point F of A. And now the continuity says that given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a delta greater than 0, such that the delta neighborhood of the point A. What is delta neighborhood of A in the real line? It is A minus delta comma A plus delta. So delta neighborhood of this point A, if you look at its image, so its image of this interval means, so for inside all these points, you have to go here. So all these points, you have to find the image, okay? And this image should be contained in the, whatever the epsilon neighborhood you drawn first, okay? So this is the definition of, same definition, you can interpret it like this. Is this clear? The same definition only. So image of the delta ball around A, its image should be contained in the epsilon neighborhood of F of A. That is what we shown here also. The delta neighborhood of A is mapped inside epsilon neighborhood of F of A. Here also same thing only we are saying, but the way we look at the image little bit varies. So for this, to get an image of this point, you go here and this is the image. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Yes, actually.
Yes, sir.
Actually, you are taking x as real numbers, sir.
Right.
It is a connected set, sir.
Right.
Instead of taking the connected set as domain, if you would take some disconnected set, what will happen, sir?
Okay, so that is a good question. Like, see,
because all like the facts you are telling,
suppose it is good enough to intervals.
You are disconnected anyway.
The disconnected can be like very. There are various disconnection. Like it can be like for example, it can be irrational. It is piece-wise completely disconnected. Like there is.
Natural number system like
that. Yeah. So like suppose this is my domain. Okay, you just two, like maybe we can take four intervals, or we take this three intervals. This is my domain, okay. Say minus four to then minus three. Then I take minus two to minus one. Then these two intervals is my domain. I want to talk about continuity. At this point, A means that I should find a delta such that it fits inside this interval. And that much is what I want. But again, if there is a bigger delta, I can make it smaller. I mean, smaller delta will also work, right? So always you can make the delta smaller such a way that it fits inside this interval. So that is not a problem, usually, yeah.
If it is like natural numbers or integers.
So, right. So it depends on the
domain set. The domain set is a discrete set. What will happen there?
So in that case, we should look at the matrix-based definition of continuous functions. So we take F from M1 to M2. So M1 and M2 are two metric spaces. There is a metric D1 here. There is a metric D2 here. Then given epsilon greater than 0, there exists delta greater than 0 such that distance between X1 comma A less than delta implies. So basically here you have D1. Here you have a distance between distance between F of X comma F of A less than epsilon. Okay, so D2. So you take any two metric spaces, this is the definition. So you can take natural number, anything, there is a metric, right? So you replace this metric here, codomain, whatever metric you replace here, so that is a definition. So an arbitrary definition, like an arbitrary metric space also, there is no ambiguity in this definition. Okay, but anyway, like natural numbers are very interesting because it is a discrete metric, as you said. So all the functions are continuous there. Maybe we'll do that example next. First, we'll do constant functions, and then we'll do why any continuous function, like why every function on natural number or integers or in general discrete metric space, every function is continuous. Let's see why. Okay, so to start with, we look at the constant functions. So they are the very simple continuous functions. Suppose I given an epsilon, this is the graph of the function, constant function, and this is the constant C. So basically every point is mapped to this particular value C. So now I claim that this function is continuous at this arbitrary point A. So you take A here, A here, A here, anywhere the same argument as your. Okay, so now I'm given an epsilon greater than zero. I immediately draw the epsilon radius around C. That is the first step we do. So I get C plus epsilon, comma C minus epsilon. Okay, now I need a delta here such that image of this interval should be contained inside this interval, right? That's what we want. But this is a epsilon neighborhood of C. So definitely C will belongs to this interval. You take any delta here, its image will be just the single point C. Correct. So image, you take any delta, its image will be definitely contained inside this epsilon. because whatever delta you take, its image f of b of a comma delta is going to be a single point. Okay, so f of a minus delta comma a plus delta, this is going to be just a singleton c, because function is a constant function. This full interval is mapped to just a c only. So c, singleton c is definitely contained, belongs to the epsilon prime root of c. Okay, so for constant functions you have no condition. You take any delta, smaller, bigger, whatever you want, condition will be satisfied. So literally there is no relation, I mean you don't have any relation between epsilon and delta. Delta can be anything in case of complex constant functions. Okay, so is it fine? So we want the delta, yeah, we want the delta neighbor root of a. Delta neighbor root of a should be contained in epsilon neighbor root of f of a. F of a is c, but that is just immediate because this is singleton c, that is why. Okay, so for everybody this is okay. We going to see such example.
Yes sir.
Okay. Yes sir.
Yeah so like many people are there, like I getting answer from like 5-6 people only. So others, if you have some doubts, just let me know. I'll be very happy to say it once again. Okay, no problem. Okay, so let's continue. So you can technically, you can take any delta greater than 0. That's what I said. That's what I have written here also. Hello? Okay, so let's look at f from R2, f of x equal to x. So f of x equal to x means, so image of 1 will be 1, image of any point a will be again a, and image of 2 will be 2. Okay, so maybe I have image of 2 will be 2. I haven't draw the diagram quite clearly, but yeah, but this is good enough for us.
It's an identity function, sir.
Yes, the function x is the identity function. So I claim that the function is continuous at this point a. So I am given a epsilon, so I draw epsilon neighborhood around the point f of a, but f of a is again what? F of a is again a only. So this neighborhood is nothing but a plus epsilon comma a minus epsilon. This function takes every point to itself. Okay, now I need a delta neighborhood around a such a way that its image should be mapped inside this a minus epsilon comma a plus epsilon. And this point going to map every point to itself. So what can be delta?
So equal to epsilon.
Yeah, we can just take delta equal to epsilon. Okay, so here also you take a minus epsilon comma a plus epsilon. Then you take any point here inside this interval, its image will be itself. Right, because this function takes anything to itself. Therefore, this a minus epsilon comma a plus epsilon, but this is like a delta. Okay, a minus delta comma a plus delta, because delta equal to epsilon, and the image of this interval will be itself. Okay, therefore, like if you take delta equal to epsilon, like all the required conditions are satisfied. Okay,
sir, by this diagram, can you tell us that when function is not continuous by this diagram?
Yeah. I mean, this function is continuous.
So this function is always continuous.
This function is continuous, sir. I want example of discontinuous function by this diagram.
Yeah, you want example of discontinuous functions using diagrams, right? That's what you're saying. Yeah, so
and
that
want
comes
to next. Understand it by this graph.
Right. I mean, not by this graph, right? By similar graph, you are saying.
Yes. But by the method,
right. That is what that's what comes next. Before that, I have something to share with you. So let's first do it. What is this? Where are my tabs? Sorry. What happened? Sorry, something happened. Here is the link. Okay. So this is the thing. Maybe first let's do this. So this is a nice website. Okay, so basically you can feed any function. So this is my function 4 minus x square. Maybe let's make it to some simpler function.
like say f of x equal to say it's a constant function 5, okay, and I'm looking, so a equal to 2 we can make it to some 0.4. so at the 0.4 it is changed to 7, I change it to 4. At the 0.4 I want to prove the continuity of the function, constant function 5, and so I can set any epsilon. Okay, so I set, suppose epsilon equal to 0.5, and we saw that any delta will work. So this is not that much interesting. So let's
if we are taking x is equals to 10x, then it's a discontinuous function, and the same in r to r.
X goes to 10x.
10x.
X goes to 10x.
10x. 10x. 10x.
Okay. No. Okay. So no, we will come to the discontinuous function next. Okay. Let's first see epsilon and delta. Let's try to understand epsilon and delta using these diagrams. Okay. Okay, so f of x equal to, let's consider this function f of x equal to x square, and we want to understand its continuity at the 0.4. So what is the image of 4? It is 16. Okay, so basically the dot, black color dot, this point is 4, 16, it is written. You see this vertical shaded region is now in red, because for epsilon equal to 0.5, delta equal to 0.5, it doesn't work. That is why it shows in red. Why it doesn't work? Because you see, maybe I take this point to be 2 diagrams equal to a equal to 2. Yeah, a equal to 2 will be a little better. Okay. I can't write here, is it? Okay. This should be fine. Only 1 minute, please. Yeah, so this is the image we saw there. And so this is the graph of f of x equal to x square. And at the point a equal to 2, so its image will be 4. And if I take epsilon equal to 0.5, for epsilon equal to 0.5, delta equal to 0.5 won't work. Why? Because this is 1.5, this is 2.5. This is a 0.5 delta radius. And image of 2 is 4. This is 0.5 radius around f of 2, that is 4. Now, if you look at image of a point from here, so you go here, and if you hit here and you go here, so it is already, it is not going inside this 0.5 radius neighbor root of 4. Okay, because you see, this point will have a pre-image here, and its image will be here. It is clearly going in outside the epsilon neighbor root of 4. So the one good thing is, you take this to 2. So one good thing is here you can adjust delta. So I make it delta lesser and lesser. At some point it turns into Q. It turns into green. So that means that delta works. Okay, so that is a point of why I'm sharing this website to you. You can play with this. You try to understand for what epsilon, what delta works like this. Okay. Another thing is, so you see a equal to 2. And suppose if I, so let's keep it here. And I am varying a between minus 2, minus 10 and minus 10. So we proved that this function, at a equal to 2, we were discussing it. Now between minus 10 to 10, I am varying the point and I am checking the continuity.
you see at some point the vertical shaded region is green, at some point the vertical shaded region is red. If it is red, then the delta is not working. If it is green, then the delta is working for epsilon equal to 0.5. So basically, if you change the point, then the delta for the same epsilon, the same delta may not work. So that is what this diagram's color changes is showing us. And yeah, you try to play with this. Okay, I will share you this website also. And like for various function, you can try to guess what is delta and you can play with that. And you can guess the general relation between epsilon and delta also. Okay, so that is why I want to share this link. So you can just check Desmos, D-E-S-M-O-S. In Google, you will get this. Okay. Okay, so that is one thing I want to say. Similarly, there is in the Desmos, there is something called epsilon delta game. So basically, if the epsilon and delta you are choosing it correctly, then this image will be, it will be smiling. If you, so this is f of x equal to x square at the point 2, and the delta is, I have taken very small. You see now the diagram is like, now it is not very happy. Now the image is not happy because the delta is, I have taken 3.6, epsilon is 1.3, that is not working. So if I take the delta much smaller, and then now the image is happy, means that epsilon and delta is working like that. So again, this is Desmos only. Okay, so these are some good applications where you can understand the continuous about continuous functions. Okay, you try to play with that. Okay, so you know who is Jarvis? You see, adjust the L and delta to make Jarvis smile. Anybody know who is Jarvis? I mean, this is off topic, it isn't mathematics, but yeah. Anybody know who is Jarvis?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Well, I mean, no need to answer that question, but just want to know whether somebody knows Jarvis. Okay. Okay, good. So let's continue. Okay. So let's go move on to discontinuous functions. The constant functions, identity functions, like for identity function, delta equal to epsilon will work. So let's look at this function. So at x equal to 0, the image is 2, and everywhere else the value is image is 1. Okay, so the basically this is 1, so except at 0 it is a constant function 1, at 0 the value is 2. Okay, so this is a discontinuous function. Clearly you see the graph of the function is not continuous, so you can see the, so we will discuss the discontinuity at all possible ways, like your continuous, open set, close set, sequence, everything. So first let's use epsilon delta. So to prove continuity, what you have to prove, you have to prove that given epsilon greater than 0, their axis delta greater than 0 such that f of b of a comma delta contain b of f of a comma epsilon. So to prove the function is not continuous at a, what you have to prove, have I written? Okay, I haven't written. So you have to prove for given epsilon greater than 0 means for all epsilon greater than 0, that should be changed to their axis epsilon greater than 0. So here their axis to delta greater than 0, so you have for all delta greater than 0, such that the conclusion should be false. It means that f of 0 comma delta not contained in b of 2 comma epsilon. So let me rephrase it. If the function is continuous at the point, so we claim that the function is not continuous at this point 0. If it is continuous for any epsilon neighborhood around its image, its image is 2, so any epsilon neighborhood around 2, you can find at least one delta neighborhood around 0 such that its image will be go inside this, right? So if it is not continuous, if it is discontinuous, there is a for all epsilon greater than 0, so whatever epsilon neighborhood you draw here, sorry, there is an epsilon such that whatever, however small delta you drawn here, its image will not go inside this. Okay, so that's the matter of language. Just if you can, you don't want this is to happen, so then you write it, you will get this definition. Okay, this is clear. Like we want to say function is not continuous at a equal to 0, so you need to find an epsilon such that for every delta, the delta neighborhood, image of this delta neighborhood should not go inside the epsilon neighborhood of 2. That is what we are trying to prove. So we need only one epsilon which work for all delta. So what is that epsilon? So now image contains only these two points, 1 and 2. Okay, so basically if you take a neighborhood such a way that it contains only 2, then you are very much done. Okay, so we take epsilon to be 0.5, then the epsilon neighborhood of 2 will be open interval 1.5 to open interval 2.5. let's see. So if you take this interval and whatever delta neighborhood you take, okay, in this interval, image of this interval will be so for points other than 0, the image will be 1. For the point 0, the image is 2. Therefore, image of this interval will be whatever delta you take, f of minus delta comma delta will be equal to 1, 2. Is it clear? Because in this interval, there is a 0 also, there is non-zero also. Therefore, image will be 1, 2. But this epsilon neighborhood contains only 2. Therefore, the delta neighborhood of 0 cannot be contained in this particular epsilon neighborhood for all epsilon. Therefore, f is not continuous at 0. Okay, so that is one reason. Like similarly, you can argue sequence argument also. So what is the sequence definition of continuous function? So we say that f is continuous at the point A if whenever xn tends to A, we want f of xn converges to f of A. If this condition is satisfied, we say that f is continuous at the point A. So to show f is not continuous at A, you construct a sequence xn converges to A such a way that f of xn does not converges to f of A. That will prove that the sequence is not converges, I mean continuous at A. So what sequence you can take? So you take 1 by n and it is converges to 0. And what is the image of f of 1 by n? So f of 1 by n, I think I have defined it to be 1. I changed a little bit. So f of 1 by n will be like 1 for all n. Therefore, f of 1 by n converges to 1. But if it is continuous, then the if 1 by n tends to 0, f of 1 by n should converge to f of 0. But f of 0 is 2, right? F of 0 is 2, but the sequence converges, f of 1 by n sequence converges to 1. So we have a sequence that converges to 0 whose image is not converges to image of this point. Therefore, function is not converges at 0. Okay. So this is a very, very, very simple. Usually sequences are much easier like to prove continuity. But if there is some properties related questions are asked in the CSIR exam, then epsilon delta will be sometimes useful. Okay. Okay, then there is a limited definition of continuous function. So you look at the left limit of the, sorry, this is right limit of the function at the point 0 and left limit of this function at the point 0 and look at f of 0. All these three quantities should be equal. Okay, then such functions are called, the function is said to be continuous at the point 0. Okay, so if the function is, suppose function is discontinuous at 0, then there are two possibilities. Either like these limits does not exist. Okay. Another thing is this limit exists and but not equal. Okay, so if it is exist and unequal, it is said to be discontinuity. Hello?
Sir, why you write f of 0 equal 1, sir? F of 0 equal 2.
But here
it is 2, sir.
Correct. So what I did was, initially I was having the values 1 and 0. Okay. Then this graph is coincided with x-axis. It was little confusing to people. So I changed it to 1 and 2. So in the proof, I forgot to change it. That was the issue. Okay. Anyway, so this is the limited definition of continuous functions. If the limit doesn't exist at all, right limit or left limit doesn't exist, then it's said to be discontinuity of second kind. if the limit exists and if they are not equal, it's said to be discontinuity of first kind. Okay, anyway, we will see that also. So using that argument also, you can see that the function is not continuous at the point zero, because the right limit will be zero, right limit will be one. When you come from right side, you are getting the images one, and when you're coming from the left side, all these values will be one. So therefore, the left limit will also one. So right limit is one, left limit is one, but the function value is two. F of zero is two. Therefore, it is not continuous. That is one way of saying. And inverse image of open set should be open. It is a continuous function. But again, like you can take this this interval. It is a open set, right? What is the inverse image of this open set? You will get only singleton zero. Okay, only zero is mapped to two. Yeah. So I mean, it is not an open set. Sometime a closed set can be open also. But that is what I'm saying. So this is a neighborhood. It is an open set. Its inverse image is singleton zero, which is not an open set. So inverse image of open set is open. That condition is not satisfied. So similarly, you can argue inverse image of closed set is also not closed. You take F to be singleton. I think you have to, again, the same problem. I have to take singleton one or singleton two. Yeah. So if I take F to be singleton two, I think I made a mistake or what? What is the inverse? What is the inverse image?
It should be one. So that's
minus.
Right. So the one I wrote was correct.
Yeah.
It should be singleton. What you're saying is correct. Anyway, so you take F to be singleton one, then F inverse of F will be minus infinity zero comma infinity, because every point other than zero is mapped to one. Right. Therefore, this is the inverse image of singleton one. Clearly, this is not a closed set. This is an open set, indeed. So that condition also not satisfied. Okay. Now let's I have some some questions here. Suppose F is continuous, then mod F is continuous. Anybody know why?
Composition of continuous functions.
Yeah. So composition of continuous functions is continuous always. So we really didn't prove, but f of x equal to mod x is a continuous function from R to R. Okay, then maybe I take this to be g of x equal to mod x is a continuous function. Then modulus of f is nothing but g composition f. Okay, so mod x is continuous, g is continuous, so mod f is continuous. What about if modulus of f is continuous, does it mean that f is continuous? Anybody know some example?
F is equal to
f
greater than
0. Sorry, f of x equal to 1, x belongs to q.
Yeah.
Minus 1, x belongs to irrational. It is
okay.
Mod f is continuous, but f is not continuous.
Sir, and you can take, sir, any function, interval going to plus value and some interval going to minus value. Then the modulus will continuous, but function is not continuous.
So maybe can I change it here? I can change it here itself, right? I can change minus 1, 1 here.
Yes, sir.
No, right? Or will it work?
Minus 1.
This is fine, right?
This is fine, sir. Yes, yes.
Yeah, this is fine. This is my f of x, but when I take modulus of f of x, at 0 also the value became 1. Because modulus of minus 1 is 1. So at 0 also, the image will be 1. So we get the continuity. Okay. So what we have proved is this function is not continuous, because at 0, it is minus 1. Everywhere else, it's 1. So instead of 2 at the point 0, I am defining minus 1 here. So by the same argument for this function, you can prove that this is a discontinuous function. But its modulus will be equal to the constant function 1. It will be continuous. Okay. So if f continuous f continuous means that mod f is continuous always. But mod f is continuous doesn't mean that f is continuous. Okay. So I would like to continue for 15 minutes at least. Will it be okay? Hello, sir.
It's okay.
Let's continue. So, this problem, maybe let's do this problem and we'll do it. I prepared a lot actually, but I prepared that only very less. Okay, but this is an interesting problem, so let's do it. Okay, so f from x to y be a function from a metric space to another metric space. Then the question is, for any Cauchy sequence xn in x, if f is continuous, then f of xn is a Cauchy sequence. It is true or false. So basically, first option says that if f is a continuous function, then image of a Cauchy sequence is again a Cauchy sequence. Or in other words, continuous functions preserves the Cauchy sequence. It is true or false?
False.
Some example, like a false means you should give an example.
The fx equals to 1 over x in open interval 0, 1, continuous. Yeah. And if we choose xn equals to 1 over n, so this is Cauchy sequence in 0, 1.
Yeah.
But the image is n, which is unbounded, so divergence
right. Sequence. Yeah, so f from open 0, 1 to R, you take these two are metric spaces. Open 0, 1 is a metric space, R is a metric space. You consider the sequence f of x, if you take it to be 1 by x. Okay, and what we need to define xn to be 1 by n, then f of xn will be n. Okay, it's because 1 by 1 by n will be n. So this is a continuous this is a continuous function. It is a Cauchy sequence, but its image is not a Cauchy sequence. Okay, what about second option? If f of xn is Cauchy, then f of xn is always convergent.
Sir, I think it's true.
Okay. Others?
No, it is not.
False.
It should be.
I think it is false because we need Cauchy in place convergent only if when it is complete.
Complete metric space. So the domain is not complete. I mean, domain is some arbitrary metric space. Okay. So what is the example?
Example, we can take 0, 1. We can take 0, 1.
Yeah, so 0, 1 is what is it, domain or codomain?
It is codomain, it should be codomain. It is
okay,
not...
what is domain?
domain should be R. Let me just find out the example.
Yeah, so maybe like I'll just say the answer, like anyway, we running out of time. So we just take f from open 0, 1 to open 0, 1, and you just take the identity function f of x equal to x. And you take xn to be 1 by n sequence. Okay, so this is. Okay, then f of xn is also again 1 by n sequence only. Right, so f of xn is a Cauchy sequence, but f of xn is not a convergent sequence because 1 by n is not converging in open 0. Okay, therefore, so first is false, second is false.
We can take a set of real numbers instead of 0, 1 as a domain.
Right. Yeah, we can take it also, but this is so much simpler. Yeah. Like, we are taking identity function from 0, 1 to 0. That is why. So I hope everybody are following. Like, if you have some doubts, please ask. Okay. I didn't say what is Cauchy sequence and all.
Sir, I have a little confusion in Cauchy sequence. So, yeah, sir, will you explain it tomorrow?
Sure. We can definitely do. Yeah. Okay. Maybe you can come up with your what is your doubt. If you can phrase it clearly, you can ask the doubts. Like, that is fine. Okay. Again, option 4 is clearly wrong, right? Like, X is some metric space only, and we have taken some Cauchy sequence. Why it has to be convergent? Right? And so again, you can take X to be open 0, 1. and you take the Cauchy sequence to be 1 by n, then it is not convergent. Okay. Okay. So the point is option C is true. Okay. So that is the beauty of this problem. So this statement says that f from x to y is a continuous function, sorry, a function from metric space to metric space. And if it takes Cauchy sequence to Cauchy sequence, then it is a continuous function. Okay, so that is a true statement. If a continuous function may not take Cauchy sequence to a Cauchy sequence, but if a function takes Cauchy sequence to a Cauchy sequence, then it is continuous. Okay, so proof. So what we have given that xn Cauchy implies f of xn is Cauchy. Okay, so we claim that f is continuous. So there is a one very very important lemma. Xn converges to A if and only if x1 A, x2 A, x3 A, this sequence is Cauchy. Anybody seen this result? A sequence converges to a point A if and only if you form a new sequence. First term is x1, second term is A, the limit you put it. So the limit you put it in alternate places forever. Okay, so this is a very simple result. You try to prove using the definition of convergent sequences and Cauchy sequences. It will be, it is one, it is, this problem is once asked in NBHM problem also. Okay, so maybe 2018 or 17 sometime. Okay, anyway, we use this result to prove f is continuous. Okay, so f preserves Cauchy sequence. So we claim you take a belongs to the domain. So domain is x. So you take a sequence xn converges to a. We want f of xn converges to f of a to prove continuity. So xn tend to a means that x1 a, x2 a, etc. is a Cauchy sequence. That is what our the result I just said. This implies that f of x1 comma f of a, f of x2 comma f of a, etc. is a Cauchy sequence. Why? Because it is given that our function takes Cauchy sequence to Cauchy sequence. Therefore, this this sequence is mapped. This Cauchy sequence is mapped to its image is also a Cauchy sequence. Okay. Okay. Its image is a. This is a Cauchy sequence means that f of xn converges to f of a. Again by the same lemma. So this alternate places some point is some fixed point is coming, and this sequence is Cauchy means that the sequence formed by these odd terms should converge to this even point. That is what this lemma says. Therefore, f of xn converges to f of a. Therefore, f is continuous at a. Okay. So your continuous function need not preserve Cauchy sequence, but if a function preserves Cauchy sequence, then it has to be convergent. Continuous. Okay, so you don't need uniform continuity anything. Just you will get continuity. Is this clear? This argument?
Yes, sir.
Can you give me one more time, sir? Okay. The statement.
Sure.
The final statement.
Sure. So in the third option, they are saying that if you take a Cauchy, suppose xn is a Cauchy sequence in the domain, and its image is also a Cauchy sequence. So basically, it means that f is some random function. It takes Cauchy sequence to Cauchy sequence, then f is continuous. That is a statement we are trying to prove. There is some arbitrary function that takes Cauchy sequence to Cauchy sequence. We claim that such a functions are continuous functions. Okay, that is our assumption. If xn is Cauchy, then f of xn is Cauchy. This is our assumption. We claim that f is continuous. So to prove f is continuous, we need to prove that whenever xn converges to a, we have to prove that f of xn converges to f of a. right? To prove that, we are going to use this lemma. So this lemma says that a sequence xn converges to a point A if and only if x1a, x2a, x3a, this new sequence formed from this sequence by inserting this limit point in the even places is a Cauchy sequence. This is a lemma you try to prove by yourself. It will be very useful in multiple problems. So now I take a sequence xn converges to A. That means that this is converging means that x1a, x2a, etc. It is a Cauchy sequence. Now f preserves the Cauchy sequence. Therefore, its image is a Cauchy sequence. So its image will be f of x1, f of a, f of x2, f of a, and so on. So now if you look at this sequence, in the even places you have f of a. In odd places, you have some other sequence. And this is Cauchy. Therefore, it satisfies the condition of this sequence. So this sequence is Cauchy means that this odd sequence is converges to the point in the even places. Therefore, this f of x1, f of x2, f of 3 converges to the point in the even place. So basically, f of xn converges to f of a. So xn tends to a implies f of xn tends to f of a. That means that x is continuous at the point a. Okay? Okay. So is that fine?
Okay, sir. So what is the converse?
We saw it, right? If it is a continuous function, it need not take a Cauchy sequence to Cauchy sequence. For example, 1 by x is a continuous function. It is not taking Cauchy sequence
okay,
to Cauchy
okay.
sequence.
Now I understood, sir.
Okay, okay. Any other doubts?
Can you prove that lemma, sir? XL converges to A.
Actually, it is very simple lemma. Like if you have, I can prove it. There is not a problem, but time is limited. Like, I mean, tomorrow means Thursday, right?
Yeah.
Oh, next class.
So yeah. So we can do, or I will just write the proof in this slide. So
sir,
this
let try, us try first. Written...
Yeah, let us try first.
Sir, first try us, and we will establish topic more.
Okay, let's. I mean, I have few more things to say. Like I just say it very quickly. So I will share this handwritten notes. You have a look at it, everything, and you try this problem. It is very simple. So I'll say the answer. So answer is 3, and you try to see why the answer is 3. Okay, and like. Yeah, maybe after you solve this, you can look at the solution here. For example, where is it? Do I have the link? Yeah, you can see the solution. Yeah, this problem is somewhere here.
Sir, this is any YouTube channel, please. So tell us name.
Yeah, it is Hello Mathematicians.
Okay.
Yeah. So I mean, anyway, you can just check it. Like you just check in YouTube, like Hello Mathematics. See, and this problem is there, but don't look at the video beforehand itself. First, look at the try by yourself. Okay. Anyway, whatever problem we did, most of them, all the problems are there in the YouTube channel. Yeah. Anyway, it is my YouTube channel. Okay. So let's look at this function. How far I can go? Like, how long I can continue? Like, from the organizers?
Maybe 8:30 is okay. 8:30 is
another 10 minutes. Sir.
Okay.
So 8:30 will be fine.
Okay. So, yeah, I mean, audience, like, it is up to you. Like, you can stay or there is no compulsion. Like, after 8 o'clock, it is your. It's up to you to stay. Okay, so let's look at this function f from R to R. F of x equal to x if x belongs to Q and minus x if x belongs, doesn't belongs to Q. Okay, then we claim that this function is continuous only at 0 and everywhere else it is not continuous. Okay, I think before this we have this function, like in the rationals you take 2 and in the irrational you take 1. So basically I have defined a function from close 0, 1 only. Okay, I'll try to cover as much as possible. So remaining things I'll point to the videos. Okay. Okay. So if you look at the graph of this function, in the rationals it is 2 and the irrationals it will be 1. So again, in this interval 0, 1, rationals are dense everywhere there and irrationals also there. Therefore, the image 2 is also taken everywhere, like a lot of points. So if this point 2, if A is rational, then its image is 2. Suppose if the corresponding point here is irrational, then the image is 1. Okay. Then one can prove that this function is nowhere continuous. Okay. It is not continuous at any point in row 0, 1. Again, you can look at the epsilon delta argument. So you take a point A. Okay. And to prove discontinuity, you have to find one epsilon such that for any delta, the image of the delta neighborhood should not go inside the epsilon neighborhood. But if you draw a delta neighborhood around A, this neighborhood contains both rational and irrational. Okay, therefore its image of this neighborhood will be singleton 1, 2. Both the points will be there in the image. But if you draw a suitable like a half radius neighborhood around 2, then it will contain only the point 2. The point 1 will not be there. Therefore, any delta neighborhood of A will not go inside the epsilon neighborhood. Okay. So again, the same reasoning like what we did before. So again, like the same problem you try to do, again, like epsilon delta, you try to do open set sequences. Sequences again much easier here also. So you try to do so open sets, closed sets. You take it as an exercise. And I'll share the handwritten notes. So from the notes, you can understand the argument here. Similarly, if you take f of x equal to x and f of x equal to minus x, again, we are splitted into rational and irrational. So we think that maybe again, this function is also not continuous at any point. But whenever such a function is given, like at rational something and irrational something, and if these two things are continuous separately, you see f of x equal to x is a continuous function, we know. F of x equal to minus x also a continuous function separately, but now they are grouped together to form some new function. If these two functions are themselves continuous, then this function is continuous at all the points wherever these two functions agree, means wherever the graph of these functions meet. So f of x equal to x is like this curve, f of x equal to minus x is this curve. So they meet at the point zero. Only at zero. So this function will continuous only at the point zero. So you can prove again using epsilon delta. Okay, so try to visualize using epsilon and delta. I have given the argument here. You go through it. If you have some doubts, you can just take the screenshot and put it in the WhatsApp group and you can tag me. I will answer you. Okay. Okay, so what we see, we have a function which is continuous in only one point. It is a function from R to R, but it is continuous at only one point. Everywhere else, it is discontinuous. Like you can prove it using the sequences. If it is a rational sequence, its image will be this point. If it is irrational sequence, its limit will be this point. So it won't be continuous. So so you try to see why the function is not continuous at other points. Use the same idea like here. For example, this sequence argument, you imitate here also, you will see that why this function is not continuous at any point other than zero. So it is an example of a function which is continuous at one point. Can you give an example of a function which is continuous at exactly two points? So by using our same idea, like you take x square minus 1 and it is 0. So otherwise means it is at the irrationals. So I said wherever these two functions, continuous functions, meets at those points, this function is continuous. So this is constant function 0. This is function x square minus 1. So constant function 0 means it is just the x-axis, right? The graph of constant function 0 is x-axis. And the graph of x square minus 1 will be like this parabola, okay? And the curve, these two graphs meet at these two points, 1 and minus 1, okay? So basically, the roots of this polynomial is the place where this function continues. So using this root idea, you can construct many examples. Like suppose three points are given. arbitrary three real numbers are given, you can construct a continuous function which is continuous exactly at three points. So you take at this point x minus a into x minus b into x minus c, and here you take zero. So for this polynomial, a, b, c are the roots, and x, this curve and this function and this function meet exactly at the points a, b, c. Or this function, this graph of this function cut the x-axis at these three points only, a, b, c. Therefore, this function continuous at exactly three points. So you can similarly do for any given finite subset of real numbers. You can construct a continuous function. You construct a function which is continuous at only those n points. Okay. Okay. So then, like, we know for finite sets. Now we go to the infinite set. Suppose I have given you sets, natural number, integers, q. Does there exist a continuous function? Does there exist a function which is continuous only on natural number, integers, q and all? Like, so you can draw, suppose it is natural numbers, then till half you take the Trichet function. Like, if it is irrational, the value is 2. If it is rational, you take 1 up to the 1/2. After 1/2, you take these curves. Like, so at rational, this value, at irrational, this value, again, rational, this value, irrational, this value. So basically, these two curves meets at only 1. So continuous at 1. Again, these two curves meets at 2. Therefore, continuous 2 and so on. So you might think that now this curve and this curve, they are meeting at this point, right? So you will get the continuity at 3/2 also. Okay, but so what you do, you define the limit of 3/2 to be some other number. So you, like, if you have understood this f of x equal to x if x belongs to rational, minus x if irrational, like, this is some similar idea. What I have drawn is the image, but image of 3/2 is not this point. Image of 3/2 is this point. Otherwise, I will get the continuity at 3/2 also, because these two graphs meeting at 3/2. Yeah, so think about it, how to write the definition of, like, f of x equal to, like that, you can write the function of this graph clearly. So think about it, how to write it. So this function, in the left side of 1/2, this function is nowhere continuous because it is rational, irrational, it takes 2 and 1. After 1/2, it goes like this. So wherever these two graphs meet, there only continuity will happen. So 1, 2, 3, at this point only the function is continuous. So if you keep doing this, you will get continuity at all the rational number, all the integers. Okay. So for a natural number, I have done it like this. So what I can do, so I can just put the dots here also. So now I'll get the continuity at 0. Again, I'll go here, I'll get the continuity at -1. So I can repeat everything to the left side also, instead of taking that Trichet function. I'll get a function which is continuous precisely on integers. Okay. So next, does there exist a function such that the set of points at which f is continuous is q? Okay, so that is the question. So the answer is no. There is no continuous function which is continuous exactly on rational numbers. Okay, so let's see why the answer. So before see the answer, we have the example of Thomas function. So for irrationals, the value is 0. If it's a rational and it is equal to p/q in the reduced form, its image will be 1/q. So if you define this function, it is continuous only on irrationals and it is discontinuous on rationals. Okay. So it is in internet, please check Thomas function. I have written the proof also. Maybe next class I will start the lecture with the proof of this function, because the proof is very interesting. Okay, so this is example of a function which is continuous only in irrationals. So there is a function which is continuous only in irrationals, but there is no function which is continuous only on rationals. So basically, like,
excuse me, sir, can I ask you? Can I ask, please?
Yeah.
If it is continuous only at the ration, then the function has to be zero, no? By identity theorem.
If the function is zero on rationals, then by identity theorem, it should be rational. It should be zero everywhere. Okay, so for example, this function is zero everywhere and irrationals. And if the function is continuous at all the points, then the function is identically zero. But I'm just saying that this function is continuous only on irrationals. So I don't know that. So the function is not continuous at rationals.
Okay, sir. Therefore, okay, sir.
You cannot use the identity theorem here. Anyway, so the main thing is,
sir, can you show the question once, please?
Does there exist a function f from R to R whose set of continuous set of points at which f is continuous is rational numbers? This is the question.
The PDF will share, exist? Right?
Okay, sir. Okay.
Yeah. I will share these things so you can have a look at it. And I have explained the answer to this question also. So you try to go through by yourself. I have defined what is f sigma g delta set. So basically, set of points at which f is continuous is a g delta set. Okay. So I have given the argument also. So q is not a g delta set. Therefore, it cannot be a set of continuity of a continuous function. Okay. Okay, that is one thing. So f from R to R. So you look at all these things. And,
so shall we continue from tomorrow?
Yeah, I'm almost done. So you look at the things, and so most of these problems, you have one more day in between. So most of the problems, it is here. Okay, you can just check here. Whatever I have given in the remaining part, it is here. So you please check. It will be, we can just skip that part, whichever is clear to you. Whichever is doubts to you, please ask it in the WhatsApp group. I will be very happy to share. Okay. So you just check Hello Mathematicians. That is the name. And you check this book also. KACZOR. Many problems I took from this book. Continuity and differences. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, maybe we'll stop here. I will share the handwritten notes in the WhatsApp group.
One doubt I want to ask, if you have.
Yeah, please. Yeah. You can ask. Yeah.
See, in some books, when we define the continuity, we at the place of epsilon, we take 1 by n.
Some, 1 by n.
Yeah, once in some books, we'll take epsilon is equal to 1 by n. And similarly, we in some proofs, I can say, the book by Kumarsan, Kikukes Kumarsan, he used many places.
Couples of metric spaces.
Yeah, in real numbers, I think.
Two author book, right? That book you are saying.
Yeah, it is Kumarsan, so, yes, Kumarsan, yeah.
Kumarsan.
Okay.
Yes, Kumarsan, yeah. So, I just want to know that when a function is continuous, so I will define the continuity for every epsilon. So instead of taking epsilon, I will take 1 by n. That's totally possible because by the Archimedean property. The thing is, for each epsilon, I want to choose the delta n, right? For each n, we will get a sequence of deltas.
Right.
So what is the I just want to find out the relation between these delta, the sequence or property of this delta n, if the function is continuous, as you told us,
and you fixed a point also.
Yeah, I have to fix a point. Yeah, it's totally. I have to fix a point. So in case when I fix a point, that means delta n should be a decreasing sequence, is it? Or it is convergent sequence.
So, but for a epsilon, delta is not unique, no? Any delta lesser than delta also work for the same epsilon.
That's why I'm saying since 1 by n is going because n is increases, so delta epsilon is decreases, so maybe that delta doesn't work. You want to say that, right?
Yeah. I mean, you can choose delta such a way that delta n not convergent. That is also possible. Delta n not decrease, that is also possible. Yeah. Because you have lot of delta. Once you got one delta, you have lot of delta. So you can choose it such a way that it is not nice. Not increasing, not decreasing, not convergent, everything you can do. Yeah.
But for a fixed epsilon, delta is decreases. So because smaller delta can work, so that can, in that sense, we can say it is.
Yeah. Correct.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, sure. Yeah. So any other questions? If you have some doubts, we can discuss for 1 or 2 minutes. Otherwise, we can stop the session.
The results we have proved for the that rational numbers, because they are dense in Q.
Yes.
So can we use it for any like dense set in R? Can we generalize?
Right, you can use it. But you need its complement also dense.
Yeah, that QC.
Yeah, right. So you know example of any other dense set whose complement is also dense?
No.
It's very simple. From in rationals, you just add a root 2 also with it. So again, that will be dense. Its complement will also be dense. So like that, there are many dense sets whose complement is also dense. So if you know some topology and all, like you know what are the topology of space such that there is a dense set whose complement is also a dense set. Like today only I was reading about it. Dense and its complement is also dense. Okay, now I mean it's immediately it is not coming in my mind, but anyway, it is there. Like if you have D is dense and D complement also dense, then you can play the same game in that metric space also, or in that topology also. Yeah. Okay, so maybe if there is no any other questions, like we can stop the session.
Okay, Arun Kumar sir, thank you so much for your nice lecture.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
Arun Kumar sir. The next lecture will be on coming Thursday around 6:30 p.m. Thank you, participants.
Thank you,
sir.
Please share the lecture notes, please.
I will share in the WhatsApp group.
Thank you,
Kudusami sir.
Thank you, sir. RC sir, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you all, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Sir, one more request. Please share the file, whatever the content shared in WhatsApp group, please share via mail.
Yes, ma'am.
We will share, madam.
Through email also, we will share the notes.
Either through WhatsApp or in mail, okay?
Sure, ma'am.
Right, ma'am.
Thank you.
Sir, thank you. Tomorrow
we'll meet, sir. Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Tomorrow we'll meet.